We'll start with some basics, and when we talk about what is radiation, it is basically energy in motion. Types can be non-ionizing and ionizing. When we talk about sources of radiation exposure, man-made sources, primarily medical imaging, contribute a lot to radiation exposure. And we also have natural background radiation exposure sources. Now, medical imaging, diagnostic X-rays and CT scans contribute quite a significant amount of man-made radiation exposure. And you should always remember that whether it's really essential to put your patient to that radiation risk or not. Now, when we talk about the safety guidelines, the occupational limit is less than 20 millisievert per year, averaged over 5 years, and public exposure limit is 1 millisievert per year. Now, ILN's limit has been reduced from 150 to 20 millisievert per year. These were some important safety guidelines which were discussed by Dr. K.K. Saxena. He also mentioned about how minimizing the radiation dose is important by using appropriate imaging-based clinical necessity, reducing exposure time, quick procedures and correct techniques, adhere to as low as reasonably achievable principles. These aspects combined together help you in minimizing the radiation dose to your patient, to yourself, and as well as your staff. So you have to remember what you really need. Then chest X-ray techniques. When we talk about PA views are preferred over AP views because there is less heart magnification, better image quality. Proper positioning and shielding are critical. Never forget about the shield and the position of the patient. Now, special X-rays and views are required when you require specific evaluations. For example, there are lateral views, oblique views, lordotic views for your apical diseases, and decubitus view to see fluid shifts and pneumothoraces. Now, coming on to the technical aspects of quality of X-rays, you must remember that you should try and avoid radiation, which is quite often seen if your X-ray is not positioned well in your ICU especially. So the mediastinum should be symmetrical, check for penetration, under-penetrated films, obsecure vertebra, over-penetrated film, miss soft tissues. And inspiration, of course, is till the 10th rib should reach the diaphragm. Now, patient preparation and safety. For a female patient, confirm non-pregnant status. Always remember that your patient should be well prepared and you should take all precautions to maintain patient safety at all times. Then protection for your staff is equally important. Wearing of lead aprons, thyroid shields, monitoring dose exposures, and machines to go regular maintenance should always be ensured. Then Dr. K.K. Saxena also mentioned about the portable X-rays, which are very often used in our hospitals these days, in ICUs as well. So, maintaining more than 8 feet distance is essential, and exposure reduces fourfold with doubling distance. So, the more the distance, the lesser the exposure. Then in ICU settings, you have patients side by side. So if it's necessary, if possible, you should do it for every patient, but then protect the nearby patient with shields, use collimated beams. And for pregnant staff or patients, it's essential to maintain distance and shielding. Make sure that if you have to really essentially X-ray or put a pregnant patient for a radiological exposure, you're using appropriate shielding. Very, very essential. Do not forget that. Now, key takeaways from Dr. K.K. Saxena's lectures were: the radiation is necessary but must be judiciously used. Follow national and international dose limits. Ensure quality imaging with minimal exposure. And patient education and staff protection are vital. Protection for everybody, whether it's your patient, yourself, or your staff at all times. Now, Dr. Sanjay Jain took a lecture on the X-ray interpretation. And he emphasized a lot on the systematic approach and interpretation to X-rays. So, when you're interpreting any X-ray, you must remember that you go in a systematic way. Like, for example, you start from the tracheal alignment, you look at your clavicles, then the shoulders, then both the lung zones, the hilum, the heart borders, bones, and never forget to look at below the diaphragms. When you go systematically, you tend to not miss smaller cues, smaller pathologies, or something which is hidden and can be picked up on just X-ray itself. Now, another approach which was emphasized by Dr. K.K. Saxena was the ABCDEFGHI approach, wherein he emphasized on the airway, bones in soft tissue, cardia, diaphragm, effusions, fields, gastric bubble, hyla, mediastinum, and then the impression. So either the approach, whichever way, always remember to go systematically, go from top to bottom, look at each field. Do not be in a hurry to interpret an X-ray. And if you can't see, just jump on to doing a CT scan. Of course, CT has its own importance. But then if you go systematically, you can pick up cues on the X-ray itself and you might not need CT scan altogether. Then important adult radiographic concepts were discussed by Dr. Sanjay Jain, which included the Sillitt sign, something very important, which we often talk about on a daily basis. Loss of normal border indicates contiguous pathology. For example, look at the right heart border. Now, the right heart border is obscured on this X-ray. And when we see this, we know that it's a middle lobe pathology. Similarly, look at the left aortic knob or the left heart border marginally over here. Majority of it is visible. So this basically indicates left upper lobe pathology. And it can also, you know, if this is also obscured, the complete heart border, then it can be a left upper lobe pathology. It can also include your lingular pathology. Now, Sillitt sign basically is important because it gives you the anatomical cues. Then look at this right left heart border. It is completely, the left diaphragm, it is completely gone. So this basically includes, this is a left lower lobe pathology. Similarly, over here, there's an obscuration on the right diaphragmatic shadow, which indicates could be possible that there is a right lower lobe pathology. This is what is your Sillitt sign. Now, again, there's a spine sign. Now, when you look at the lateral view, the lower thoracic spine should become darker like this. Okay, the absence of which indicates that this is a left lower lobe pathology. So these signs are important because they help you pick up cues. Like, for example, in this X-ray, if you're in a hurry, you might miss a left lower lobe pathology, or you might think that there might be something here if you're careful and if you're systematic in your approach. Now, coming on to the next sign, which is a cervicothoracic sign. Now, sharp lesion borders above the clavicles usually indicate an intrathoracic or a posterior mediastinal lesion. However, if the borders are blurred and there's a cervical extension, look at this. Now, this is from the thorax to the cervical. Can you see the blurred borders and the cervical extension? So this is generally in the anterior mediastinum and it could be a goiter. So don't always think that it is a intrathoracic pathology. Always think of cues, always try to look at the borders. Now coming on to the hilum overlay sign. Now when you see visible hilar vessels like this in this X-ray over the hilum, this means that the lesion is either anterior or posterior to your hilum. If these vessels were not visible, that means that your lesion is over the hilum. So that is what is the hilum overlay sign. Now the Eisenmenger phenomena and the hilum convergence. Mark prominence of main pulmonary artery. Vessels, when they converge towards the enlarged hilar shadows, this indicates pulmonary arterial hypertension rather than a mediastinal mass, like seen in this X-ray. Now, how do you differentiate per se between alveolar shadows and interstitial shadows? Alveolar shadows would be segmental or lobar. They would be fluffy with ill-defined margins. You could see air bronchograms, possibly a bat wing appearance. And interstitial shadows, there would be linear, reticular, nodular opacities concentrated in the lung periphery. And they're suggestive of interstitial lung disease. Now, key to air bronchogram. It confirms a lesion in the intrapulmonary, that is within the alveoli, and bronchi are usually patent, seen in diseases like pneumonia and ARDS and other alveolar processes as well. For example, look at this X-ray. You can see clearly the air bronchogram through the X-ray. So if you look carefully, you can appreciate all these signs. Now, when we talk about important pneumonia and cavitation features, a lot of times when the patient has a Klebsiella pneumonia, the fissure would bulge like this, which is very typical for Klebsiella pneumonia and is called a bulging fissure sign. Now with cavitations, a thick cavitation of more than 4 mm usually suggests an acute process. However, in some cases of cancer and malignancies as well, you might find a thick walled cavity. So don't just stick on to the thing of it being an acute process or an infective process or just being an abscess, it could be something chronic as well. However, mostly chronic lesions have thin-walled cavities. And of course, causes we all know, it can be fungal, tuberculosis, septic emboli, your aspergillomas specifically. Now, when we talk about ILDs, we generally have this thing of doing CT scan and just sticking to CT scan. And of course, in ILD suspicion, we have to proceed for HRCT for confirmation. But there are chest X-ray cues as well. Radiographic features, of course, include reticulations, honeycombing in cases of advanced fibrosis, ground glass opacities in NSIPs. Usually, the key patterns that we see is for UIP pattern in IPF, sarcoid with reticulations, hilar lymphadenopathies bilaterally, and lymphangitic carcinomatosis. But in the X-ray, this X-ray is showing you extensive pulmonary fibrosis. So not just always keep in mind that CT is going to be it to diagnose fibrosis. This X-ray does give you, along with history, clinical examination, you can proceed to a CT scan, but then this helps you in identifying that your patient has fibrosis. Now, miliary pattern, tiny nodules throughout the lung fields, commonly in 1 to 3 mm size nodules. So miliary tuberculosis is common, then can also be seen in fungal infections, hematogenous metastasis, and dense calcified nodules are usually old granulomatous diseases like Heal TB or maybe an old fungal infection like histoplasmosis. Now, you can see that in this X-ray, bilaterally, there are diffuse small nodules of less than 1 to 3 mm in size. So very commonly seen in miliary TB. Now, as you can see, this X-ray shows a lung abscess in the right upper lobe. Now, something again that we commonly see in our regular practice is skin fold and pneumothorax confusion. So, you know, it is not very difficult when you do a systematic approach. Also remember that a skin fold will be irregular, less sharp margin, and vessels would be visible beyond the fold. In case of a true pneumothorax, you would see a sharp pleural line and absence of vascular markings beyond. Now, there's something known as a deep sulcus sign, which is generally seen in supine X-rays in ICUs a lot. And you would see a deep, sharp costophrenic angle with a basal pneumothorax. Your costophrenic angle would be deep, it would be sharp, it would be devoid of vascular markings. So whenever you're suspecting a pneumothorax, you should remember this. And always remember that there can be an artifact in a clinical setting when there is not a possibility of a pneumothorax. You should not forget that and carefully examine. For example, look at this. Can you see this going beyond, out of your thorax? So this most likely is a skin fold. And then there are a few markings which are visible. However, you know, whenever there is a doubt like this and, you know, clinically you've examined your patient, less likely, always repeat the chest X-ray. Then pulmonary embolism, there are a few signs which can be appreciated on a chest X-ray, like the oligemia, the Westermark sign, the Hampton's hump, and the enlarged central pulmonary artery. But always remember that pulmonary embolism also requires other diagnostic criteria as well as clinical presentation that should never be forgotten. Now, key chest X-ray signs when we talk about, there are a lot of stripes and lines that were emphasized by Dr. Sanjay Jain, and he had mentioned that these stripes and lines give you specific cues about abdominal widening or convexity, which suggests specific pathologies like lymphadenopathy, esophageal dilatation, your mediastinal masses. You should not forget about the retrocardiac and basilar cues, because these also help you sometimes identify pneumonias, masses, or other pathologies. Bones and soft tissues should always be looked at. Artifacts, again, very important. Systematic approach, again, I would emphasize, when you remember this, when you look at it, you must remember that there can be artifacts in a setting wherein a patient does not have any clinical cues or presentation, and it's less likely what it's shown or seen on the X-ray might be the presentation. So always, always have your clinical aspect in place as well. And always reconsider or redo the X-ray if really needed. Now, artifacts like hair plates, skin lesions, misplaced tubes can simulate a pathology and can lead to misdiagnosis. Pneumothorax versus bulle. Look for clear visceral pleural lines. Bulle are often multiple and they are thin with thin walls. Now, look at these two X-rays. You know, this was a hair braid which was here, and look at the repeat X-ray, it has disappeared. So that, like I was talking about artifacts, if you have a female patient with presentation which does not suggest any pathology which could be present here, or you think that there are no clinical cues, there is no presentation, in this sort of an instance or scenario, you can repeat the X-ray. Then differentiate AP versus PFM, scapular over the lung fields, Hyatt size exaggerated in AP, oblique views with a marker on the tender spot for rib fractures. Pregnancy, X-rays are permissible with lead abdominal sheets. Use collimated beams, very, very important for your pregnant patients. So the key take-home points are: look for slit and angle signs to localize lesions, pleural versus parenchymal. Use consistency across views, for example, frontal, lateral, and decubitus to differentiate between hydropneumothorax from abscesses. Identify subtle signs of pneumothorax, especially in ICU, deep sulcus sign often missed. Recognize mediastinal lines and their displacement or widening as early indicators of pathology. Subtle changes in mediastinal lines and retrocardiac areas are critical for early detection of pathology. Always correlate radiological signs with clinical history. Very important. When in doubt, you can confirm with definitive CT diagnosis, but don't always try to jump to a further investigation radiologically. Chest X-rays remain indispensable and underutilized. Mastering their interpretation avoids unnecessary use of CT scans, and radiation awareness exposures is vital. Judicious using protects patients from long-term harm. Master the chest X-ray and use spare your patients unnecessary scans, as well as risk of radiation, associated problems. Thank you.